Hi, my name is Sheldon Livesay. I'm the director for One Accord Ministry, and we're right at Easter time, and I want to tell you an Easter God story. And so help me, this is a miracle too. But at Easter time, I love Passover, and I've studied Passover. I've taught Passover. I love it when the Messianic Jewish groups come to a church and they teach Passover, but we're in Appalachia, and I tried many years ago to bring one of these groups to our Good Friday service. We had a community Lenten type service, a Good Friday service. So I tried to get one of these groups to come and share Passover and what it meant. And it's hard to get them. We can't guarantee how many people's going to be there. We can't, you know, we couldn't guarantee the things that they were asking. So they decided not to come. And at the same time, I was so interested that I got videos and I learned it. And I said, well, next year I can do it myself. And so for many years, I've been able to teach Passover, and we've had Passover. I've been to Jewish Passovers, Messianic Jewish Passovers, and Christian Passovers. And we've done them here in the ministry that I work with, of One Accord Ministry. In fact, I do it every few years here, have the full Passover meal so people can experience Passover, and every single thing in Passover points to Jesus Christ. Everything. And I'm not going to go through that. We're going to do a Passover and video that so that you can share with that too. Jonathan Kahn does one. You can look that up on YouTube. And he does a really good job. But let me go back to ours. So we're getting ready to do our Passover here in the Ministry Center. We're setting the tables. And we've invited staff, and we've invited some of our friends. We have some prayer groups, and we've invited those folks to come and to be a part of it. And this little girl comes just walking through, and it's in a ministry center, and we have a thrift store, and we have to walk through this room if the store is open, because they go from the upstairs down to a lower level where we have other items. But we have this good-sized meeting room, and we had all the tables laid out, and she's asking, what are you doing here? And we said, well, we're going to have Passover tonight. And her eyes lit up, and she said, you're going to do a full Passover here? And I said, yes, we are. We've got people that are going to be coming, and some of our staff want to learn about it, so we're excited about it. And she says, well, good, can I come? And I said, yes, you can come. And then as she walked out of the room, she said, well, I'm so excited because I'm Jewish. Okay, I'm thinking, am I going to offend this lady? Because everything I do from the very beginning of Passover to the very end of Passover, it points to Jesus. And as a Messianic Jew or a Christian, we are always focusing on how it represents Jesus. We're talking about how Jesus at the Last Supper, how he went into the upper room and how he went through the very ritual of Passover. We know the very prayers that Jesus prayed that night. We know exactly what happened. We know about Jesus taking one of the three pieces of matzah. You know, there's three instead of one on a table, and they take the middle one out that represents, okay, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. The middle one's the Son. He would have taken that out in front of his disciples, broken it. Matzah is striped. It's pierced. It's broken, representing the suffering that Jesus would have gone through. And he wraps that in a napkin called an afikoman, and he hides it under the table. And we're going to go through the four cups that are poured that night: the cup of sanctification, the cup of judgment, the cup of redemption, and the cup of blessing or praise. That is the one at the end. And there's blessings that are said. Jesus would have gone through all of this. So he would have gone through this ritual, and then there would have been a time at the end of the ritual, it lasted about an hour, that they had supper together, and he would have shared supper with his disciples. And I'm guessing this is probably when he did the discourse that we find in John 14, 15, 16, and 17, where Jesus is trying to help his disciples understand that he's going to have to go away, go back to heaven, and because he can't be with them everywhere, right? He's going to send them to the ends of the earth, and he can't be with them and go with them, so he's going to go back and be in heaven where he can send the Holy Spirit to live his life through us. course, his disciples didn't understand any of that, but he comes back then to the final part of Passover, and that's where we get our communion from. Now, I'm thinking this little girl is going to come, and she's going to be highly offended because we're going to pick this matzah up that is represented being in a napkin, which is a grave cloth, and Jesus would have unfolded that in front of his disciples, and he would have broken it yet again. It's pierced, it's striped, and now it's broken. As Jesus passes that around, he's holding it in front of his disciples, and he said, "Men, this is my body. For 1,500 years, the nation of Jewish nation has looked towards what is going to be happening in the next few hours as I go through this period of suffering, carrying the sins of the world on my back for you and for me." And so Jesus is trying to, he's explaining that best he can as he's sharing this. He said, "This is my body." And then he picks the fourth cup or the third cup up, and it's the cup of redemption. And he prays a prayer that all Jews pray. "Blessed are you, O Lord our God, creator of the fruit of the vine, who redeems us with outstretched arms." He's saying to his disciples, as he passes this around and tells them to take of it, he says, "This is my blood. In the next hours, I'm going to lay my back open as the Romans beat me and they lay that whip in my back and shred my back, and they're going to put me on that cross tomorrow, and they're going to nail nails in my wrist and in my feet. And I'm going to hang there until I die." He's not been able to say this, but this is what it means. And for 1,500 years, they've recognized that. So here we begin this night. And this little girl comes in from being out where I'd never seen her before. And I'm trying, she's sitting over on my right side, and I'm trying to read her facial expressions, but I've got a job to do of teaching people what Passover means and the fullness of what it represents. And so I'm explaining every little detail and particle, and I go through all of that, and no expression. I can't read anything. And then I come through the period where we eat supper and we're talking and doing all of that. And then we come back to this part that we get communion from. And we make it communion when I teach it. So we have it all, and everybody partakes of the matzah. They drink of the cup as we would in communion. No response from this little girl. I can't read anything. And then when we get through that part, when I teach Passover, I love to just go into worship. We have Easter songs that we sing, resurrection songs, victory songs that are written that are so good to sing to boost our hearts and our minds, and it helps us fulfill all the things that Passover was meant to be. You know, it's not about the law, it's about the heart of God. Jesus came to emphasize that over and over again. He said it's not the written law, it's not keeping the letter of the law, but it's keeping the heart of God, pleasing God. And he said Passover should be followed by all generations. It's how we understand. There's so much more in the fullness of it, but you have to come back to that to understand that. Anyway, so we go through all of this. We're doing these praise songs, and just a little bit before this started that night, you know, it just came to me that it would be nice to have the Jewish blessing, number 6-5, that is, that a Hebrew would say, someone would say in Hebrew, and then maybe in English. And I found one on the internet. I was so excited because it was a Jewish rabbi, and he had his shofar up, and he blew the shofar to announce the feast, and then he gave this blessing. He gave it in English, and in Hebrew, and then he gave it in English. And I was looking, and for the first time of the night, this little girl came unglued. Her eyes were dancing. She couldn't stay still, and she was there, and she enjoyed this as we went through it. But that was the very last thing, and as soon as it was over, she ran to me, and she said, "Where did you get that? Where did you find that? How do you know him? How did you know?" And I didn't want to tell her, "Hey, honey, I just looked on the internet 20 minutes ago before we started, and I happened to come across this." But listen to this, friends. This is what it's all about. She said, well, I'm a Jew and I'm from Chicago. And I grew up in a very tiny little Jewish synagogue. It was only some older adults in it, and I was the only child. She said, but up the street, about two blocks, there was a bigger Jewish synagogue. The only thing is they were Messianic Jewish folks. But they had a lot of youth, and they had a lot of activities, and they started inviting me to come to their activities, and I started going. And there was a rabbi in this synagogue, and that rabbi, over a period of time, knew when the time was right, because he would explain to me about all the connections of Judaism and Christianity and how this man by the name of Jesus came to die on a cross for our sins and give his life for us. He was buried, but he arose from the dead. He defeated death, hell, and the grave for us. And if I can simply ask forgiveness for my sins, and if I can surrender my life to him, that he will come and live his life in me and make me a brand new person. And she said, so I found Jesus at this synagogue. This rabbi led me to Messiah. And she said, so I am a Messianic Jew. And she said, and that's him. That's my rabbi. She said, I'm going back tomorrow to have Passover in my synagogue with that man that was there. Now, friends, I'm telling you, isn't God good? Doesn't it make you excited just to serve a God that does this kind of thing? Of course, we're out in the public more. We are a ministry that works 5-6 days a week, and I'm out a lot of times on the seventh day of the week also, but I get to see maybe more of these things than many of you that are at work. But I'm telling you, every single day I see God at work somewhere, and it's so exciting, so refreshing. And here at this time of year that we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we see him at work through his church, through his body, through believers, every day somehow. So I just want to say thank you for allowing me to share that. God bless you, and you have a great day.